In this video, you will learn how to look amazing in your hybrid meeting by setting up video, and you can do it with any budget. Your hybrid meeting could look like this. This is my full hybrid meeting setup, but even if you have a much smaller setup, you can still look great and create an inclusive atmosphere in your hybrid meeting. My name is Marcus Seppälä. Here I help you engage your audience. So here's the agenda for this live stream. We're going to talk about three components. One is the cameras that you're going to have in the room. And I said cameras in plural because you will probably want to have multiple different cameras. And we'll look at some exceptions later on. Next, we're going to talk about stabilization. And that is, what are you using to actually hold the camera stable, like a tripod? And finally, we will also discuss different ways of approaching screens in your room, because you will probably have multiple screens as well. Listen, I'm happy that you're joining us live. Throughout this presentation, there are links in the video description below. So just look behind the video on if you're on a computer, and if you're watching this on a phone, just tap the phone screen and tap the little arrow next to the title. So let's jump into the content here in just a moment. You can also download my hybrid meeting checklist, by the way. There's a link to it in the video description as well. So as we talk about cameras first, the most obvious camera for a hybrid meeting is going to be your laptop camera. It's also going to be the worst possible camera, but I think it's useful to start talking about it from that perspective, because one of the points that I want to make here is that you don't need fancy equipment. So here's one of the hybrid meeting setups that I have used in my Toastmasters club. In the center, there's a conference speakerphone. That's for audio. We're not talking about audio today. On the right-hand side is a phone. We'll talk more about that later. But on the left-hand side is a laptop. And we're using the selfie camera on the laptop to show the speaker to the online audience. The purpose of the phone camera on the right-hand side is to show the audience to the to show the in-room audience to the online participants. So a laptop camera is a great place to start because you already have one, and you shouldn't have to have a lot of expensive equipment to get started with hybrid meetings. It's much more important to have an inclusive atmosphere. So long as your audience members online and in the room can hear and see each other, you will have yourself a great hybrid meeting experience. The next type of camera that you could consider, which is also a great place to start, is to use a smartphone camera. Most smartphones have two or more that you can use for your hybrid meeting. And an example would be this. In this setup, this is actually a photo taken earlier this week from my Toastmasters club meeting. And we have mounted the camera on top of a desk stand. Let's put that full screen so you can see. So at the top of that desk stand, there is a camera, and the selfie camera is pointed at the stage. You see where the podium is. This is our stage area. Then we also have the conference speakerphone on the bottom left-hand side. So a phone is a great place to start because it's flexible. You can place in many different places, many different ways, and it's also high quality. If you're using Zoom, the Zoom app is also really, really good. So a phone camera is our second choice for hybrid meeting cameras. We're going to go through a bunch of different choices here. But laptop and smartphones, those are things that you already have. And the reason why I encourage you to get started with them is, let's go it like this. The reason why I encourage you to get started with phones and laptop is because you should learn how to build a great hybrid meeting before you invest in the gear. If you find out that you don't even want to do hybrid meetings, then investing in the gear may not be a great choice. And in any case, inclusion is more important than the equipment. And in this setup, for example, the audio comes from that conference speakerphone, which is and the audio is much more important. Let's move over to the next type of camera that you could use, and that is to use a real camera. Let's put that on the screen as well. I'm going to put that full screen for you. So this is my kind of standard hybrid meeting setup that I would typically use if I want all the bells and whistles in my setup. On the far left-hand side of this picture, there's a stage area. There is a camera in the very center. That's the one we're going to talk about, pointing at the speaker. so that the people on Zoom can see the speaker. There's that same conference speakerphone at the center of the table. There's a projector on the bottom right-hand side, which is showing the Zoom meeting to the in-room participants. And then there is a phone, and the purpose of that phone is to work as a second camera to show the audience to the online participants. But as we're talking about a real camera here, the one that I'm using here is the Canon M50. There's a link to it in the video description. And there are two ways of setting up a real camera like this for video conferencing or hybrid meetings or for live streaming. There's basically two ways of setting it up as a webcam. One way is to set it up as a webcam is to use a USB cable. And that is actually what I'm using here in this setup. There's a USB cable running from the camera into the laptop. And that is the same setup I'm using right now to create this live stream. With the Canon cameras, the quality is lower than the other methods, but I hope that you will agree that the quality is good enough. So if you look how the image quality in this live stream looks, I think you'll agree that this is definitely good enough for a hybrid meeting. And the cool thing about using it, setting up a real camera with a USB cable is that the cable costs like $10, or you can get three of them for $10 even. And then you just get the free software from the camera manufacturer and you'll be able to use it as a webcam. So Canon has this, Sony has this, Nikon has it, Olympus has it, Panasonic has it, Fujifilm has it. Everybody has this free webcam utility. For Canon, it's called the EOS webcam utility for my series of cameras. So that's one way of connecting your real camera, I just bumped my mic there, to connect your real camera to your laptop as a webcam. The second way to do it is to use HDMI. And the most of these cameras, they have an HDMI port, which is used for video and audio signal. With the HDMI port, you will get a higher quality image, but it requires a little bit more specialized equipment, because while the normal USB cable, you can just connect that into a normal USB port, an HDMI cable needs a special connector on the laptop. And the product that you need is a capture card, something that will turn an HDMI signal into something that you can use in a computer. And the leading brand here is Elgato, and they have a product called the Elgato CamLink, the Elgato CamLink, also linked below. If you're going to use an HDMI signal, then you also need to take care of one thing. You will get higher quality, yes, but the signal needs to be a clean HDMI signal. And what that means is that many cameras, like my camera, for example, it will show icons and things on the display even when you're outputting it via HDMI. So for example, the shutter speed and the ISO and the focus box. So make sure that your camera has a clean HDMI signal before you start considering this approach. The last thing, so we're talking about what do you need to use a real camera as a webcam. The last thing you need there, you see that there's two cables hanging from the camera. And the second cable is a power cable. You can, of course, run it on a battery as well, but my camera will only give me 2 or 2.5 hours of battery time. So having a stable power supply is key. And what I use here is a dummy battery and an AC adapter kit, also linked in the description. By the way, if you're wondering where you can find all the gear that I use, I actually have a website for that. You can go to marcuspresents.com/gear. Everything I use is there, not only for hybrid meetings, like all the products that I use and love. So we talked about the real camera. So what I'm not saying, what I'm not saying is that you should go out and buy a $700 camera just to use in hybrid meetings. But what I am saying is that if you already have one, then consider using it as a webcam, as an extra benefit. For as little as the cost of a USB cable, you could actually turn a real camera like this one into a webcam. And that's what I'm doing here. The next possible solution for video in hybrid meetings is to use a separate webcam. This would be something like a Logitech Brio or something like that. I don't have a I don't have a webcam myself. I have used it in one of my hybrid meetings and it was a good result. If you have one, consider that. And the benefit of using a real webcam, once again, is that you just plug it into the USB port and attach it to something like a tripod or some elevated surface, and you'll be able to get a good video quality for your hybrid meeting. Then we have the next topic, or the next choice, which is a camcorder. That's what I had on the thumbnail for this particular live stream. And in fact, I had this camcorder on the live stream. This is the Canon XF100. And so the question is, can I use this for my live stream, or for my hybrid meeting rather? And the answer is no. And this is the same reason, actually, it's a similar reason to what we were talking about before. But this camera is like 10 years old, and it does not have an HDMI out port that I can use while the camera is in operation. So, and of course, this is not going to be a problem for all camcorders. So if you do have a camcorder, we can output a live HDMI signal, which is also clean, that doesn't have all those indicators, then that would be another choice for you as well. So I hope you're starting to see that in order for you to set up video in a hybrid meeting, there are so many different tools that you can use, and you probably own many of them already. Getting started with a phone or a laptop is a great place to start, and you can easily level up from there. But one of the things that you may have noticed here is that in all of the pictures that I showed you, there are actually multiple cameras, and this is key. Because if you're going to be setting up a hybrid meeting, let's say with a real camera like this pointing at the stage, you also want to have a camera pointing at the audience. And this is actually very important so that the people who are joining the meeting online, that they feel that they are included in the meeting. And you can achieve this if they can see the in-room audience. So if we look at the setup here that I've been talking about, let's put that completely full screen for you, just one moment. So the main camera there in the center, it's pointing at the stage, but then we have the phone camera there, and this is obviously a sterilized version of it, but when I'm running this meeting live, that phone camera is pointing at the audience so that the people online can see them. And obviously, I'm taking this photo here with one camera, so I can't display it in the photo, but I actually usually have two cameras, two phones in the room. And what I like to do is to have one phone pointing at kind of one half of the audience and the other one pointing at the other half of the audience. That's a great way to create that inclusive atmosphere. So multiple cameras is key for that inclusion, and it could be your own phone, it could be somebody else's phone. If you're going to be, even though we're talking about video today, there is one audio comment that I will make. If you're going to be adding a second device, like a phone, for example, that has audio in it, you have to disconnect the audio on that second device. If you don't disconnect the audio, you will get echo when one microphone picks up the sound, and then it goes through the speaker on the phone, and then that gets picked up again, for example. And in Zoom, what you do is that you go into the menu and then you click a disconnect audio. It is not enough to only mute it, and it is not enough to only turn down the volume, because at least with my Zoom app, I cannot turn the volume down to zero. It is critical to disconnect the audio. Hey, smash the like button if you're getting value from this video so far, because we're going to talk about the next type of camera. So what I said previously is that you should have multiple cameras so that everybody in the room can be seen. But there is another solution to that problem, and that is to use a proper video conferencing system that will track the not only the active speaker, but will track the rest of the in-room audience members as well. And one example of a video conferencing system that I have used is this. This is the Poly Studio, also linked in the description. So if you look at this device, at the center there is a camera, and then on the sides there are speakers and microphones. So what this device is actually three things in one: microphones, speakers, and camera. And it uses those microphones to decide it uses those microphones to decide who is actually speaking, and then it zooms in the camera on that person by framing them correctly. This is what it looks like when it's in our meeting room. It's on the front there. So we're not using any extra cameras when we're the only other equipment here is the laptop and the projector. So a video conferencing device is a good choice, and you might have one in your room already. Another popular brand here is the Meeting Owl Pro, but I want to show you this in action. I'm not only going to talk about it, I'm going to play you a little clip with the Poly Studio just to show you an example of how this can actually look when you run it in a hybrid meeting. This is a clip of just over 1 minute, so I'll be back in a moment.
In this sample, I'm sitting approximately 1.5 meters away from the Poly Studio. Microphone check, 1, 2, 1, 2, microphone check, 1, 2. Now I'm gonna stand up and walk to the other end of the room where we have our stage. And we're gonna see how quickly the Poly Studio is able to focus in on me now that I'm standing on stage. Microphone check, 1, 2, 1, 2, microphone check, 1, 2. This is at approximately 5 meters distance from the device. I'm going to grab a seat right here to my left, and we're going to see once again how well the Poly Studio is able to pan over and focus on me as I'm sitting down at approximately 5 meters distance from the device. Microphone check, 1, 2, 1, 2. For the final test, I'm going to walk over and grab a seat a little bit closer to the device, approximately 1.5 meters again. And I see that it focuses on me as I was standing up. And now that I'm sitting down, let's see how long it takes for the Poly Studio to reframe me now that I'm sitting down at the table. And there we go. This is a microphone check. 1, 2, 1, 2.
So that's a little demonstration of the Poly Studio and how it tracks the speaker. And any other video conferencing system that is modern and up to date will have this kind of feature as well. And it's a really good way to build that inclusion because everybody in the room will be seen. And then when the person speaks, the device will zoom in on them. Now, of course, there is a cost barrier attached to this kind of system. I think the Poly Studio costs something like $800 or $900. The Meeting Owl Pro that I also mentioned, which is also linked below, costs around $1,000. So that's not going to be feasible for every type of meeting setup. But I just mentioned it here because it is a very good way to create those inclusive hybrid meetings. Of course, there are much more expensive solutions as well. If we're talking about the kind of $20,000 budget, I had the opportunity to use a device called the Cisco WebEx Room, and there's a 55 and a 70 version of that, which is also really good at it. It's not only a camera and speakers and microphone, it's also a screen. So it's like really all-in-one video conferencing setup. But We're going to continue from now on with a more budget-friendly approach. By the way, if you're getting value from this kind of free training right here on YouTube, you can make a small donation by buying me a coffee. You can do that at buymeacoffee.com/MarcusPresents, and that link is also in the video description. So let's continue. Let's continue with the next step. And the next step is actually going to be about the stabilization. How do we make sure that the camera actually stays in one place and that you can change the angle and other things like that? So let's move over to that. And if you haven't hit the like button yet, hit the like button. So for stabilization, the most obvious place to stabilize your equipment is a table, very exotic thing. So here, for example, this is what I call my core hybrid meeting setup. It consists of a projector to the left, then there's a laptop in the center, there's a phone, and there's that conference speaker phone. The phone is directed at the audience, the conference speaker handles audio in and out, and the laptop does many different things. It runs the meeting, it is connected to the projector, it is also connected via Bluetooth to the conference speaker phone, that's the PolySync 20, by the way, and then it also works as the selfie camera on the laptop is directed at the stage. So this is, I call it the core setup because it will deliver a high quality hybrid meeting, but at a budget, but it will still be quite good. So in this case, we're just using the table to stabilize the laptop. The next choice is if you have a podium, especially if you're going to be if you have like a specific area where you're going to be presenting, using the podium as a stabilization is going to be good. So in this next photo, this is was taken quite a long time ago at Basel International Speakers, which is our Toastmasters club. So here we are using the podium as a support, as a stabilization, as a floor, basically, for the laptop, where the selfie camera on the laptop is directed at the stage. The next choice is a music stand. And I'm including this because we have used the music stand a number of times. Actually, you're going to see three different times in this video. So here is an example of using the music stand. And for this, I'm going to put it full screen. And I want to draw your attention not to the tripod in the center, but to the stand on the right-hand side of the image. You see that there's a music stand standing there on the right-hand side of the image, and it's actually holding the laptop. So if all you have is a music stand, you can definitely use it. And this turned out to be stable enough. And this stand that we're using here, it's actually, it can put it completely horizontal as well. That's what you're going to see later on in this video as well. So if you have a music stand, use that. And the point of all of the stabilization stuff that we're talking about is that you want to get your camera to as close to eye level as possible. If you just have your laptop on the table, it's going to be looking up at your nose. It is not a flattering angle. So whatever we can do to elevate the camera is going to be a good choice. And this music stand is a good choice. Yeah, you will also see a little bit later on. The next stabilization equipment, you've already seen it in many of the photos, and that's going to be a smartphone tripod. So here's an example of this. And this example is from a hybrid meeting that we ran completely without a laptop. So we lost the Wi-Fi, we lost the projector, we lost the laptop. So we had to reimagine this meeting with our phones only. So the main phone that you see there that I'm speaking into, that's held up by a laptop. Not the laptop, but a phone tripod. And that is actually that music stand that I mentioned. So we turned that music stand into a table to elevate it. And then the phone tripod is holding up the phone. There's another device, actually. I'm going to show this to you. Oops, that's not what I meant to do. The other device that you can see there, let's do that. That you can see on the phone is actually holding there we go. So the other device that you can see there on the table is a phone clamp, and it's actually this phone clamp right here. So you can just pop a phone in there, and then this is designed to be mounted on a real tripod, but you can actually put it standing on the table as it is standing there, and it will be perfectly vertical. It's not the right elevation, it's not the right angle, but it is good enough. And especially when we had to improvise something when everything failed, this was a pretty good choice. So a smartphone tripod is a great tool. Here's another example of the smartphone tripod in action. This is called the Joby GripTight One smartphone tripod, also linked in the description. And of course, if you go to marcuspresents.com/gear, you will find all of the gear there as well. And so this is a device that costs just over $20. And the flexible legs of it will actually allow you to mount it in many different angles and many different positions. So it's a pretty cool tool. Do we have any more stabilization options? Well, absolutely we do, because we have a camera tripod. You've already seen it before. This is the Canon M50 that I talked about earlier, and it is mounted on a real camera tripod. The benefit of mounting on a real tripod is that it's super flexible in terms of the adjustments, because you can adjust the height of it. You can adjust those legs in multiple different segments. You can get it as high as you need it to be. But it's also easy to to adjust the angle because it has a handle on the back. That tripod head is called a three-way head. So you can adjust the pan, the tilt, and the lateral tilt as well. So if you're going to use a real camera, you should probably also use a real tripod. But if you have a real tripod and you want to use a mobile phone, a phone clamp like that I was talking about before is a good choice, because you could just mount the tripod right there. Let's move over to the next idea. And this is when I was talking about this video before, I mentioned that I was going to share something brand new, hot off the presses, and it is this. It's going to be a desk clamp. So this is a kind of a stand that clamps onto your desk, and I'm going to show it to you. There we go. So what you can see here, you saw this earlier on as well, is that that smartphone is held up by the smartphone clamp, but the stand itself just connects to the desk. And this is a really great choice if you're going to be using a phone as a camera, because a phone as a camera, you have to have it fairly close to your face. So we have our stage area here and where this picture is taken, and the phone should probably not be more than a meter from your face for you to get a good quality image. So by mounting this, it's just a little clamp that you screw onto the table, completely removable, right? So this kind of clamp is a good choice because you can mount it so close to the speaker. So highly recommend that kind of clamp. Then it is the newest addition to my hybrid meeting setup. In fact, I'm using it right now. One of the lights that I'm using right here is actually held up by exactly that clamp. It's called the Small Rig Selection Desk Stand. So lots of the choices for stabilization, and we're going to look at the next topic, which is the different screens that you're going to use in the room. Listen, if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, just hit that big red subscribe button. It is completely free, and there are new communication tips coming every Thursday. I am very close to reaching 4,000 subscribers on my channel. So if you want more communication tips every Thursday, hit that subscribe button. Now I realize that I should probably actually update my script, because I don't release a video every Thursday. I actually release at least two videos every week. Usually there's one on Monday or there's a live stream on Sunday. Regardless, subscribe. That's the whole point. Let's continue. Let's move over. So here's what we talked about so far. We talked about the choice of camera, and we talked about the choice of stabilization. The next topic I want to talk about is the screen that you have in the room. Remember that the point, that because we're talking about video overall, so one part of it is the camera in the room so that the online participants can see you, but the other part of that equation is a screen in the room so that the in-room participants can see whoever is joining the meeting virtually. And we're going to see some of the same equipment here, but from a different perspective as well. So the first type of screen, and the most obvious type of screen, is your laptop screen. Similar to the laptop camera, it's probably going to be the worst screen that you have because it's small, it's awkward, it's not going to be bright enough, but it's a great place to start. And that is exactly what we did in our hybrid meeting setup as well. So this is our very first hybrid meeting setup. The screen that you see where it says Zoom, that was directed at the audience. And then the phone that you see in the center there, let's put that full screen. The phone that you see in the center there, we were using the selfie camera on the phone pointed at the stage for the speaker, and then we were using a lavalier microphone and a Bluetooth speaker. This was not the best hybrid meeting setup, but it was our first hybrid meeting setup, and we have learned from that. So if all you have is a laptop screen, then use a laptop screen. And one of the examples that I like to give here is that, because I don't have a lot of good things to say about laptops in terms of audio and video equipment, but I have run a complete hybrid meeting with just the laptop on that, just behind me here, there I have my dining room table. And I was able to run a hybrid meeting with seven people. I think we were five in the room, two online, with just a laptop. And it wasn't great, but it was okay. So if your laptop screen is all you have, then use a laptop screen. And one point actually about this setup here. So while the screen was, of course, far too small and people were not able to see any visuals, it may be more important to kind of see who's there. If you can see some colorful moving shapes on the screen, at least it gives you more of that inclusion, even if you can't see the details. Let's move over to the next type of screen that we're talking about, and that is going to be a phone screen. The screens on your phone are usually quite high quality, a little bit smaller, but they can certainly work. And the example that I'm going to give you here is this setup. So here we have three ladies looking at the phone screen. And this is from that meeting that I mentioned before when we lost our Wi-Fi. So we had to reinvent the whole meeting, run it only with phones. And this was actually the phone of one of the guests. So she set it up running on mobile data and connected to a Zoom meeting. And then for these three meeting participants, that was their screen. Not great, but good enough, good enough. And once again, it's set up with this phone clamp right there. So phone screen is a decent choice. And there's another aspect that I want to talk about. So in these two examples, I talked about the screen. So from the perspective of the audience in the room, but of course, you also have the screen from the perspective of the speaker. So for the speaker, if all they're looking at is a small phone screen and it's close to them, that's okay. That's okay. I think where it becomes difficult is for the rest of the audience members. If you're enjoying these mobile tips, smash the like button. The next and perhaps more obvious type of screen in the room is the projector. And this is going to be a good choice for most people if you have a projector screen or a white wall to project to. And this is in fact what we use in our hybrid meeting setup. So we have the project, it's a permanently mounted projector canvas on the wall there. And that projector screen ensures that the people who are in the room can see all of the Zoom participants. Really important for that inclusion. So this is a solid choice. One of the challenges, however, is if you're looking to buy a projector that works in a meeting room environment, it is not easy. Like the projector we have is garbage. It's not a great projector. It's good enough, let's say. But the budget projectors, which is what ours is, I think they're designed for like home theater where the environment is otherwise quite dark, right? But this kind of environment where you have bright lights, it is difficult to get a good quality with a budget projector. If you already have one in your space though, use the one in your space. Same thing for the next point here, and that is if you have a TV in your space, use that. And a TV might be a much better choice, actually, because you can expect them to be more quiet. A projector makes quite a lot of noise. If you're going to use a projector, you better use some kind of noise suppression on the audio side. So either a conference speakerphone with noise suppression or use the noise suppression in Zoom. But with a TV, you don't really have that problem. So if you already have a TV in your space. But then we come to the next type of question when it comes to the screens, and that is individual screens. So far we talked about a screen that is there for everybody in the room, kind of the audience. And then we talked a little bit about the one that's for the speaker. But one question that often comes up when we talk about hybrid meetings is that what if everybody just logs in with their own individual device, either their own individual laptop or their own individual phone? This can work, but it requires some preparation. And I'm going to show you an example. Here is an example. Let's put that full screen. So here's an example of a hybrid meeting that we ran a couple of weeks ago. The setup is quite different. We are using a phone as a main camera, is mounted to that music stand that I talked about before, and is mounted with that flexible mobile phone tripod. But you can see that there's actually within this view, you can't see it. Let's put it to completely full screen. So here you can see that in this room, there are actually two laptops. There is my laptop on the right-hand side, the black one, which is, its only purpose is for me to use the selfie camera and to run OBS Studio on it. OBS Studio is the software that I'm using to run these slides, by the way. So it's the software that allows me to switch between these different views and switch slides. If you want to copy my slides, you can do it at marcuspresents.com/OBS. Anyway, so I'm using that to run OBS, but the main meeting is run on that Mac over there. So here we have two laptops. And so I have the when I'm sitting at my black laptop, I have the opportunity to look at my screen or at the projector. Let's do it like that. The audience members on the other side, they can look at the screen or at the Mac laptop there. And this creates two interesting points that I want to mention. Firstly, for this to work, this is the same rule that I was mentioning before about the audio. For this to have even a chance of working, you have to disconnect the audio on everything except one device. In this particular case, we actually run the whole audio through the phone, which is attached to the music stand. And it was connected to that conference speakerphone, the PolySync 20. So the, both of the laptop had their audio disconnected, which is something that you have to do. It's not enough to mute. So that's one aspect that's very important. The other aspect that is important is that it becomes a little bit weird when there are multiple places where people could look. And if I'm standing here on stage in this setup and I'm speaking to the audience who are in the room and online, the people who are in the room, they're going to look in many, very, very many different places. Some of them are going to look at me physically, but that's probably going to be the minority. Most people are going to look at a screen, either the projector screen or on one of the laptops. So if you're considering this kind of setup where you have multiple screens in the room, do not get distracted by the fact that the audience are going to look at them at different times. It's super weird to be speaking in a room where people are looking at screens, but it is definitely what happens. Listen, we're going to take some questions from the audience in just a moment, but I want to recommend another video. So today we're talking about video in hybrid meetings. If you want to learn more about audio in hybrid meetings, then click or tap the screen right here for my video about audio in hybrid meetings, where I'm going to talk more about these conference speakerphones, cheap microphone solutions, and more advanced options as well. I appreciate you being here, and I will see you in the next video.